So great. Welcome everyone. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, depending on which time zone you are in. I am Kunal Dabir and I'm going to talk about what makes Apache Groovy a great scripting language. Let's just talk a bit about myself. I'm a VP of engineering at Medly. We are into health tech. I have written a book on Gradle titled Gradle Essential. I have been coding for around 20 years now, including languages like Groovy, Kotlin, Java, Scala, TypeScript, Ruby. I have dabbled with multiple languages. These are some that I have worked on professionally. I am open source enthusiast. I try to contribute as much as possible to open source, and I host my own open source projects also on GitHub. And I care deeply about developer experience and, in general, productivity. So probably that's what leads me to this title of this topic as well, because that's what makes Groovy very special to me, because that is the language I use to make sure my setup is productive and developers are happy. So let's get into scripting. What do I mean by scripting in the first place? We typically hear scripting in two contexts. One is wherein we are altering behavior of some running software by using a DSL, and at which Groovy definitely shines. We have all seen Gradle, Jenkins, ScriptRunner for Atlassian, Jira, SOAP UI, and multiple such products which leverage Groovy for its scripting capabilities. And they use Groovy to expose a DSL so that the users of the system can configure the system at runtime. Other languages like Lua or Python or JavaScript are used in this context as well, right? But what I'm more interested in this topic or in this talk is standalone scripts, which are run traditionally from command line and useful to automate mundane tasks, which we don't like to do day in, day out. So this topic or this talk will focus on the second half of this one, right? Let's just, for a few slides, I'll just focus on some examples to make my point that why Groovy is great for any kind of scripting. So let's just take a very simple example. A lot of time I read blog posts, some examples, and typically the dependency that is mentioned there is in Maven coordinates. And I really want to convert that to Gradle because that's what I use as my build system. So this is your input and the output needs to be SLF4J in the shorthand form. Now I wanted to script this, and there may be plugins or websites available that does this thing for us, but it's interesting exercise to do for ourselves. So first, let's just build the logic. What do we want to do? We want to parse the XML and produce a string. And for this simple task, I can just start with a Groovy console that comes with Groovy installation itself. Let's just statically hard code string here. Let's not worry about the XML file or anything like that. Let's just try to parse this XML. We can use the provided XML parser. Recently, the package structure groovy.util.xml slurper has been deprecated, but it is now moved to groovy.xml.xml slurper package. So you can still use it the very same way. And you can use parse text method on XML slurper to parse a static string. It converts this into an object representation of the XML node. In this particular case, the dependency is the node. And we are getting that on line number 9 as dependency variable. And then I can just extract dependencies, group ID, artifact ID, and version, and use the text method on each node to extract the string out of that. So this, if you run on Groovy console by using command R, most likely on Mac, you can see the result. So we are good. This is working. It's just that we want to refactor it a bit and make it more functional. I'll just explain this in a brief. We are still parsing text, but we are, instead of holding the variable or holding the reference to that node in a variable, we are using with, and with exposes that variable in this context. So now group ID is automatically called on the reference of dependency. Same for artifact and version ID. And we are creating a list which is returned from this. And this star dot is my favorite syntax. It's equivalent to the map or collect method in Groovy, which maps over a list. So I'm mapping over this list of group ID, artifact ID, and version, and extracting text on each of these objects. And then finally, I'm joining them by colon. So this was great, but is it usable? No, I don't want to always run Groovy console and then paste some string and then copy some string from here and there. So we can do is receive this input from system input. We can run this command. Let's call this Maven to Gradle and then produce the output on system out.println. How does it work? So before even I get into system in, I need to check that whether it has some bytes available. We can totally skip this if check, but then this program will block on system.in. So it's better that if we check system.in.available, and this is a truthy value if it has anything more than zero. So if it is unblocked, that is there is some data on system.in, then the program enters into this condition. And then we parse system.in. Now just look at this text. It has changed from parse text to parse. The parse method can take an input stream and it parses the text out of that. And then XML slurper converts that to still the same dependency object. And rest of the code is same. We are just printing it out to system out println. So println is just shortcut for that. But essentially what we are doing is we are receiving the input from system in and producing the output to system out. Now that is a lot more usable, but how do we use this entire piece of code? So we have to run this from command line. Let's say I do this echo and then paste that snippet and pass it or pipe it to our command. Let's call it Groovy is the command name for the Groovy binary. And then the next one is my file name in which this code was written. And it, if we run this, it produces this output. What is interesting is I can actually replace this echo part and on Mac OS, and same functionality will be available on different OSs. Just to make my point, I'm using Mac as example in all the subsequent cases also, but it can be replaced with the OS specific command. But pbpaste essentially pastes the data from clipboard, passes, and this pipe passes this output to the next command. Whatever the next command produces as output, which is what we saw is org.sl4j text, that will be again copied back to clipboard. Now that is like more usable. I like how it feels now that I just copy from a blog post a dependency. I run this command on my command line and my clipboard has the shortened dependency now. But we can still improve the user experience, right? I mean, this is good, but we can do better. So right now you still see you don't want to type pbpaste, then pipe, then Groovy and all those things. So how do we make it shorter? So first thing is like within this file, let's introduce this first line, which is called a hashbang or shebang. What it tells is to the OS when it encounters this file that use this binary to execute this program. So essentially I can run this script without Groovy command, which will be ./ Maven to Gradle, right? But before I do that, I need to also kind of make it executable. And while I'm doing so, let's even drop the .groovy extension. So it just looks like a system command or any standard command, right? So I'm moving or I'm renaming my file from Maven to Gradle.groovy to just Maven to Gradle. And then I'm making it executable. So now it looks much interesting, right? pbpaste ./ Maven to Gradle pbcopy. That this is quite close to usable. Now that ./ is also irritating. Like you have to be in this location to run this script. So I might as well copy this to my user local bin directory, which hosts all the binary files or commands. There are three options I can present to users. Either you can do just copy like I did here, or you can do a symlink, or you can put the file where it is and add that to your path environment variable. So your location of script, if the directory containing that script is in path, then your script is still available everywhere, right? So you don't have to be in one specific place to run this command or one specific directory basically. So now it is even simpler. pbpaste Maven to Gradle and pbcopy. But I can still do a bit better, right? I want to create an alias in my ZSHRC or your bash profile, just called m2g. And now pbpaste Maven to Gradle pbcopy is also taken care of. So I don't have to repeat myself. So now it's completely dry. And we can see this in action. Like I just copied this dependency. I execute the M2G command, which is just an alias. It invokes Groovy, it processes that and puts the data in my clipboard. So this makes the life a lot simpler, right? You just copy the command with command C, you copy the dependency with command C, it is in your clipboard, you execute the M2G, and it is back to your clipboard again, the new dependency or the shorthand form of dependency. So this is where Groovy really shines. Like, all these things were not Groovy, but Groovy interplayed so well with the existing systems. We can even do better. Like, if you don't want to have this file on your machine, what I can do is script is live right now. You can actually try it in your browser. You can actually try it in your command line. I have created this Maven 2 Gradle as a URL shortened URL. So Groovy command can actually load scripts directly from the web and it can run them. So essentially, when we run Groovy and some URL, it actually downloads the file. It can actually handle the redirect also. So in this case, git.io is actually referring to a gist. That gist is hosted on GitHub. And then that script is downloaded, and then I can do pp paste and all those things. And you can create an alias of this command. So you don't even have to download the Groovy script locally. So this can work like magical because you don't have to download the scripts. So if the script ever updates on the URL, you get the updates automatically. You don't have to do any dependency management or anything for this particular script. If the script had any dependencies internally, which we'll talk about later in this presentation, which can be using grab annotations, then that can also work with this model. So use shortcodes, provide custom shortcodes. I have given this pro tip here that you can create a custom shortcode so that URL is memorable and you can just pass it on to your users. This is a very nice way to distribute your Groovy scripts to the world. Let's take another example. Since I mentioned grabbing, let's do this thing. I just want to parse CSV data and we are grabbing an external library. CSV parser is not there by default in Groovy. Groovy contains a lot of things by default in its standard library. CSV is not, unfortunately, one of them, at least to my knowledge. But just adding this one line and CSV becomes available to your script. There is no build-in required. There is no download dependency. There is no class path to manage. You just add this grab annotation, which contains this shorthand form of the dependency, and then import this dependency directly. And as we can see, we can parse an inline CSV, but it could very well be in a file or some other place as well. And then I'm iterating over each data record of this CSV. So I can actually run this command as groovy and csv.groovy if the file name was CSV. And it prints the data. It did not print the first row. It understood that first name is the name of that column and last name is the name of the second column. And I can reference it that way. So that is the beauty of this parsing library. I just created another command. Again, this is just to show how easy it is to create commands in Groovy. What it does is just like we do git status, I want to do a GitHub status also. Like, what are the open PRs for a given repository? Open pull requests, basically. How many issues are open on this given repository? And what is the traffic that is there, right? So if I just run it on my repository, is my repository and KWR is my username, GitHub username. And if I run this command, it tells me what are the open PRs, what are the open issues in this repository, and how many visitors visited it last week. So how did I do this thing? Again, this is very simple. We are going to use GitHub API. We are going to use GitHub token to access private data, which is the traffic data. I create this file is split into two sections. In first section, we are just capturing the inputs. We need the token, so I'm taking it from system environment variables. I'm not passing it from command line. This must stay private. Then the owner is args0 and repo is args1. That is the first and the second parameter to the script. And then I'm calling three methods, which we'll see in the next slide. But that just prints all this data. And even the next slide is like too simple to explain. I mean, if you just look at the line number 28, it is actually receiving an endpoint and then makes a JSON request or makes a HTTP GET request, which then because and that also we have to do because we have to pass the authorization token, which is GitHub access token in this case. And then we can just parse that response, and that JSON object is available to us. Now, using this getJSON method, I have created these three methods, which are line number 16, line number 20, and line number 24 in this example. And I'm just looking at open pull requests, open issues, and the traffic data, right? The submap method just shortens or just selects few keys from that map. So that is what is giving me the data that we saw in the UI, like here, the count and the unique. So that is only, we are picking some elements from JSON. And that the script is done. I've just created something like RSS feed reader on CLI. So I want to introduce one concept here. The things that you see in bold on the script are the RC file dot exists, right? And the values for that RC file. I'm reading this file from user home, and then on in that directory, I have a file under config directory called news URL, because I want users to be able to configure the feed URL. But if they don't have it, if this file does not exist, then I'm just using Google News. And then if I just parse this feed, I can, like, if you see the last three lines, I'm just iterating over each item in this feed, and I'm just printing the title and the date when that news was published. And we can see its output here, like top stories from Google News. And these are today's news. So this is dead simple scripting for fetching news just in 4 or 5 lines. And this also includes considering users' preferences. I'm reading users' preference from user home directory, right? So it's not hard-coded in the script. If I want to change the feed URL, I could be very well using BBC or CNN or whatever that I wish. And I'll just put that news URL file with that URL. And I'll start getting the new feed, which is coming from a different URL. We can even go further with this, like storing, caching, and doing a lot more interesting checks that did I read this news already, then I don't want to see that again, and those things, but not covering here. One thing that I easily skipped over right now was managing secret, like a GitHub token in last example was one kind of secret that I wouldn't want to put in a plain text file. So where should you keep such secrets? So my preferred location for secrets is if that secret can be plain text like a token, then I put that in the environment variable. But if I don't want to use environment variable for that, there is a better facility provided by your OS, and it is available all on 3 in different shape and form. In Windows, it is a different utility. On Linux, there is a different utility, but on Mac OS, you can access keychain, and keychain can store your passwords or any secret stuff. It does not have to be password. There is a command line tool called security, unsurprisingly. It stays in user bin directory, and then it can find a generic password for a given service. So given service and a user, minus S is sample service, and user name is sample user. So it could be any user. And I'm just, now the beauty of this is a valid Groovy code. Although it looks like a command line, it actually the next two things after that, like executing that command line and reading the text from that execution, is what is the Groovy magic there. And Groovy is actually executing this command. If you paste it in CLI or in your Groovy console, this will actually work as long as you have a sample service and sample user, and it can read that text. That will be my password here, right? Whenever you run this thing, you will be prompted by your OS to enter your OS password, basically, because it is securing that. So as long as you know your OS password, which happens to be your login password, basically, then this program will be granted access to the asked password, in which case it will be sample user and for sample service. But I want to do it in code as well, right? So we can use a library called jkeychain, and this has been a forked library. There are 2-3 forks which are there. I'm using one of that, but again, it essentially is the same API. Right now, I'm showing one example to add one generic password as well. So I'm adding a password to sample service for sample user. So sample service could be, let's say, GitHub. Sample user can be my username and there may be other username, or my let's say organization name and my personal account, right? I can have two GitHub tokens. So that can be sample user or any other user there. So I'm adding a generic password. And towards the end, I'm showing how do you read a generic password using this. This is not available in Maven Central, or this particular library is not available in Maven Central. And hence I'm using something called as Grab Resolver. What this does is it goes to a different Maven repository and makes it available for scanning. So the next line, the grab, that library would be searched for in this location as well, which happens to be JCenter. But you can be grabbing more dependencies. You almost have entire GitHub available at your disposal. If you use Jetpack, Jetpack can build any arbitrary project on GitHub or GitLab and produce the binary or the artifact from that project and make it available to you for download as a Maven coordinate, right? This makes it extremely easy to you access the projects which are not available on any Maven repositories, not even JCenter or any other repositories, right? Those that are not even published by the author can be accessed via this method. And there is one more hack. If you always find yourself adding this thing to your Groovy script, then I might as well recommend to add this thing into your Grape config. Just give me a second. So Grape config is the file in which there are multiple Maven repositories listed and they're globally available for your Groovy installation. So the downside of this will be if you are going to share this script with someone else and you are relying on Grape config file of your local machine, then your script will not work on other machine. And that's a very important point to remember, that who are you writing this script for? Are you writing this script for yourself or are you writing the script for other users to be shared? And if you are writing it for other users, then the first method is better one. So let's quickly jump to some best practices that I recommend when you are writing some scripts with Groovy. Do one thing well. I will always emphasize on this one thing. Just do one thing, reading the RSS. So just read RSS. Don't try to be an email client. Don't try to be, let's say, Emacs there. Not to piss off any Emacs users. Collaborate with other programs. Don't reinvent the wheel. Like you saw the example, I can read password from the security utility of macOS, or similarly for Windows, I can do a check and access it from Windows system. But don't reinvent that wheel. Don't try to store password in a secure way or do something on your own. Pipe in and pipe out, like we saw in our first example. You don't have to actually access files. You don't have to ask user for files. You can just pipe data in and pipe data out. While you are doing so, you also have to be very conscious about what goes on STD out versus what goes on STD error, because anything going out on STD error means that your program is in error state. You should also provide, and if you are providing something to STD error, then you should provide a right exit code also. Don't exit on zero, because exit zero means the program terminated normally. And if you are abruptly terminating, then use some different exit code. It can be any integer, small integer number. Don't hard code any file or program paths. I did one, like in my example, I shown you user bin and security, but that is an outlier. I did not want to use any program path there because someone can maliciously create an alias for security, and we don't want that. So we want to make sure that security is used from that exact precise location, and hence that program's path was hard coded. So unless you have very sound reason for hard coding, don't do that, and try to make sure that your paths ideally are agnostic to OSs if possible. If not possible, then at least multiple machines. Like if you are running on two macOS, it should work. Use hashbang on first line if you are using Groovy. It makes it a lot simpler to just execute without Groovy command. And store application data at designated places only. We'll see what those designated places are. And store environment or use environment variables or OS specific secret stores for storing secrets. These are some places of interest that I want to definitely highlight where you should store data. I don't necessarily imply that we should be storing to all of these locations, but I just want to quickly glimpse over what these locations are. you should be storing application data. Let's say if we are writing some SQL file, SQLite database or HSQL or H2 database, then this should go here. Like whenever we want this data to be persisted, we don't want this data to be wiped. So it should be stored in this location. And I'm just using macOS locations here, but you could be finding similar locations for Windows and Linux. I have given that reference at the bottom. If you're writing settings, so it should be going to preferences. Caches. Caches are something that are purgeable. Like some, you are creating some indexes, or it is some, in case of my RSS feed, I download the feed and I just want to cache it so that it does not have to download it again. But if the cache is deleted, it doesn't impact. I'll still be able to download it fresh. So then those things goes to caches. Logs, where you write the log files, of course. Secrets should go into environment variable or keychain. These next three things are very important. Temp files, if you create, you should delete them, and you should use this system get property for accessing the tempdir. Don't hard code any path there. So this these three properties will actually work agnostic of OS and will give you the right path on your current machine. So current dir is where the command is getting executed if you are running a script from a location or a project or a directory. So this is that directory. Current dir or the user dir will return you that directory. And user home is my home on like the tilde, where all things are installed, or my files are kept. Basically, on Windows it may be C users and then your name. On Mac it is users slash your name, and different OSs have different thing, but this is very important location. So these are some places of interest, and you should be placing the data generated from script or for reading in script in the right locations. Distribution of the script, right? This is a very important topic. We already saw two mechanisms in this presentation itself. If your users have Groovy installed, you can just share one Groovy script. Groovy is beautiful. There is no other file like a build file or a dependencies file or any lock file that you have to share. It's just one script, easily shareable to anyone if they have Groovy installed. If your script can be public, then just host it on Gist and people can just use it with a shortened URL. But if your users can not have Groovy installed, let's say for whatever reasons, then we can package the Groovy script as a jar file along with Groovy and the dependencies. And I have created a small package. This plug is exactly for that. That lets you create package from a Groovy script that is distributable. So you just have to give this zip file to the third party or to your users. Once they extract the zip file, they automatically get a command to run on Windows and on Linux and macOS. And your script along with Groovy all and the dependencies is packaged, right? I just use Gradle's application plugin to create that. And this is open source. You can just check this thing out. I have also created a short URL for the script itself, so you can check that as well. It's called Groovy Script Packager. So if you go to I have given this command at the bottom. You can just use that. What are the tools that I use for this? Everyone's mileage may vary, but I use SDKmin to manage JDK versions, Groovy version, and Gradle version. I use Groovy console to play with the Groovy simple commands like we did in the first exercise, and also to analyze the AST, that what is Groovy generating. If you don't know about AST, just don't worry about this at this point. I use item or terminal for running CLI commands. I sometimes use Groovy SH for using it as a REPL mode. You don't want to execute some part. You loaded a file into memory and now you want to just run some commands on that file. So Groovy SH is very useful. If you are using Groovy console, then that file will be maybe downloaded again and again or created again and again. And we don't want to do that. I use Sublime Text for just plain text editing. And then I use IntelliJ IDEA for full blown IDE experience with autocomplete and suggestions for like completing the dependencies that I just downloaded, including the ones that I downloaded using Grab. So finally coming to what actually makes Apache Groovy a great scripting language. This is where I want to like quickly summarize. It is an expressive language, familiar syntax for those coming from Java. It has a rich standard library with JDK enhancements. It is called as GDK. It has inbuilt dependency management system called Grab. It has strong and mature ecosystem of Java libraries. So you can just use them as is in Groovy. No need of separate build and deployment system or dependency management system. You can just easily share the scripts. And it has strong backward compatibility, both at GVM level and within Groovy also. It has dead simple IO. Again, these are very simple examples of how I can do simple things simply in Groovy. How do I write to text file? How do I append to a file? Or how do I execute a process? How do I read something from a URL? Or how do I traverse a file tree? These are not more than one line in this language. And that is the real beauty of this language. In fact, producing or consuming JSON and XML is dead simple. I mean, I have not seen this simple in any other language. This cannot be so simple in any statically typed language because you have to have your POJOs or whatnot to map your JSON responses to here. You just play with hash maps and everything is sorted. It's very beautiful for scripts. You can run SQL, like groovy.sql. SQL is a wonderful class. And this is a full functioning example in which I'm connecting to Postgres server locally. I'm also reading the system env.jdbc URL because you might want to expose the JDBC URL via environment variables, and same for username password. And then I'm using Postgres driver. And then for each row of this query, I'm just printing that row. And it can't be simpler than this. If anyone has used raw JDBC, they know the pain of this thing. A few words of caution. Some caveats, like even in the last few examples you have seen, I had to mark fields as annotation because fields are by default not accessible in your methods that you write in script. If those methods are in a class, it's a different story. But if you are writing top level methods or functions in your script, then fields are not accessible. You just have to annotate them with fields annotation to make it accessible. Loading one script from another is not very easy. Although writing everything in one script is dead simple, but if you have to include two scripts, then you have to immediately start dealing with class path or something else, but it's not that straightforward. And also, like in the last example, you might have seen or noticed the system class loader for grabbing JDBC drivers, because a lot of times your driver must be available before anything executes. And that is where you remember to have a system class loader equal to true for your grab annotation. Some shortcomings which I have observed when I'm writing scripts in Groovy. One is ecosystem is largely dependent on Java libraries, which is not necessarily a bad thing. It is a good thing. But the bad thing is very few idiomatic Groovy libraries. If you have seen Spock, such a wonderful library, and that is a first class Groovy experience. But there are not many libraries which give you that first class Groovy experience. And hence you are dealing with mostly Java wrappers. And those Java wrappers sometimes are maintained, sometimes are not maintained, sometimes are not ergonomically as good as Groovy can be. And we are essentially stuck with that. It is also like to teach Groovy to someone who is not from Java background, it's difficult because they have to know Java then, and then they can learn Groovy. Although it's not entirely true. I have seen people getting productive with Groovy without understanding Java, but still it lacks that appeal. For non-Java developers, they are much more comfortable with picking something like Python or JavaScript rather than Groovy. And Groovy is not installed on a lot of target machines. Like if I'm writing scripts for everyone, they may or may not have to be installed for which exactly I have created this packager, which solves that problem. But with SDK man, having Groovy installed on target machines is becoming very easy now. Cool. I think I have made it to the end. Nothing could be better than like putting this mandatory XKCD. Because this is reality of my life. Like I try to automate things. I think it will ease my task, and I keep on automating more and more. So it keeps on taking ongoing development time for me. Not really true for Groovy, but it's for me. And with that, I just want to keep last 5 minutes for any questions and answers that we might have. Thank you.